be surrounded.
Before I start this list, I'd like to remind everybody that I'm a human with changing opinions. So if you don't like anything I say in this video, then just wait a year and maybe I'll say something different. But in the meantime, you can tell me what you think in the comments. Because that's what it's all about, baby. That's what we're all here for. I just want to open up a friendly dialogue and tell you why you're wrong. I'm gonna be excluding greatest hits albums for obvious reasons, because if I didn't, then Curtain Call would obviously be number one because of FAC. I'm also basing this off of the deluxe and or B-sides or refills, so I'm taking every song made for that album into consideration. Anyways, let's start this off at number 10 with the Slim Shady LP.
I'm cancerous, so when I dance, you wouldn't wanna answer this. If you responded back with a battle rap, you wrote for cannabis.
The only reason this album's last for me is because it's his first, and I believe that he got better over time. And this one's just kind of his least professional. It's got arguably the worst mixing as well. It's kind of cranked up on the mid-low end, which is weird. At the risk of sounding pretentious, I don't really think hip-hop fans mostly listen to records for the mixing, though. So I have a feeling that might be one of my most controversial picks. I also think the way his voice sounded in this album is my least favorite. I'm not a huge fan of the nasally drugged out Eminem.
Why you care if you're scared to death? Are you that chick? Do you really think she gets a...
But hey, I know any 40-plus-year-olds will probably feel the opposite, and that's cool. And I want to make it clear that I love every single one of Eminem's albums. I'm not here to shit on any of them. But I'm gonna go to the other end of the scale for number 9, because Music to be Murdered By is next.
Chopping him up like Dom with the nut, job with the nuts to the bigger than job of the hut. I'm in the cut in the mouth of the blood. It's looking like it's that time of the month. Carving him up with the bars while I sharpen him up. Dogging him up, I'm gonna fuck your mom in the butt with the thermometer.
We've got his first and most recent one. I just feel like MTBMB, especially with its B-side, has some of the most forgettable tracks. And it also doesn't seem like he puts as much emphasis on his hooks as he used to. He's kind of been in this mode for the past 5 years where he's just like flinging out lyrics without having the whole, you know, congealed songwriting process there like he used to. But I don't know, there's some really cool stuff going on here. I was actually on a vacation when this album came out, and I happened to be on a car ride where I could just sit there and listen to it all the way through. And I was really fucking blown away by certain things. Whenever it kicks in Premonition, I was like, oh, okay, he's gonna go pretty hard in this album. And then I got to Godzilla, and I was like, wow. Wow, he's still competing with himself.
I'm beginning to feel like I'm mentally ill. I'm a teller, killer, be killed. I'm a killer, be the vanilla gorilla. You're bringing a killer within me, out of me. You don't want to be the enemy or the demon who enemy, or be a receiving enemy.
But I don't know, over time, most of the songs just kind of sound flat compared to his other work. The mixing literally sounds flat as well. If Slim Shady LP isn't his worst mixing, then this album definitely is, which is weird. Like, his voice sounds kind of muffled in most of the songs, and the beats don't have a very wide soundscape. Look at me. Here I am, shitting on stuff. I said I wouldn't do it, but I have to explain why I'm ranking these the way I am. So I need to be able to tell you why I think this album's worse than the others. I'll get nicer as the video progresses. Anyways, number 8. Ooh, this one might be controversial as well. The Eminem Show.
These ideas are nightmares to white parents whose worst fear was a child with dyed hair and who likes earrings.
I'm gonna say this right now before I carry on. Sing for the Moment is one of his best songs. I think my differing opinion with this album is literally just style preference. It's got that nice early 2000s hip-hop sound that almost sounds like polka inspired or something. Nas's album of the same year, God's Son, sounds quite a bit like it as well. Listen to The Cross by Nas. It literally sounds just like an Eminem beat of this time. And I'm here for it. It's really cool. I just don't think there's that many songs in this album that really stand out. I know people are gonna argue about White America, Business, Cleaning Out My Closet. I love Soldier. Soldier's amazing. I think Till I Collapse is kind of overrated, and I'm a tiny bit tired of Without Me. Of his pop-friendly songs, I just don't think Without Me is as strong as the other ones, but whatever. Eminem Show, great album. I'm tired of saying bad things about it, because it's still great. Number 7, Encore.
I'm supposed to be the soldier who never blows his composure, even though I hold the weight of the whole world on my shoulders.
Literally all of the reasons that I placed Eminem Show so low apply to this album as well. This is basically like a sequel to the Eminem Show. But I think the songs that stand out in this album are better than the ones in the Eminem Show. To me, Ass Like That and Just Lose It are some of his best funny songs. And Ass Like That just genuinely sounds so fucking good. The beat is crazy.
The way you shake it, I can't believe it. I ain't never seen a
ass like that.
Plus, I think most people would agree Eminem's flow in Encore is kind of like a unique little pocket of his career and is pretty gnarly. He kind of does this thing where he sounds like he's gonna throw up while rapping.
There's not much you could do or say to faze me. People think I'm a little bit crazy. I get it from all angles, even occasionally Doc Dracy.
Also, Mockingbird and Like Toy Soldiers are just fucking phenomenal songs. To this day, those two songs are some of his most deep emotional works. Since we're talking about the Encore era and we're not including any variety albums, I'd like to just bring up the song No Apologies from the re-up. If you like Encore and you've never heard that song before, you need to listen to it. It's epic. Excuse you. God damn. Holy shit. There's this tiny little space where my blinds are not covering the window properly. There's just this beam of, this single beam of light just going directly into my fucking face. It's fucking up my whole shot.
I can fix that.
Number 6. You might not be ready for this one. Prepare yourself. It's Revival.
A one night stand turned into night stand. It was called some lights grand. Now we hung tight and he found out.
I think the hate that this album got was almost entirely just wrong place, wrong time. That, and it is a little bit of a mixed bag. There are a couple songs on this album that are some of his worst work, but there's also some that are his best, in my opinion. There's hardly any Eminem songs that I find unlistenable, pretty much, but Untouchable is one of them. I cannot stand Untouchable, and I know most people feel that way too. But I think Walk on Water was a beautiful way for him to open his heart up to his audience. Believe is incredible and was one of the most unique songs of his. Chloroseptic, I just want to play this little part from Chloroseptic because I love it so much.
What kind of nut drives a Budweiser? Truck finds a slut, tries to surprise up, cuts ties up, binds up, cut slices up twice. But the MacGyver must just like it rough, fuck right in her vagina. Blood flies up on the Kaiser like a geyser.
Like, who the fuck does that? We've also got Tragic Endings with Skylar Grey that basically sounds like it belongs on Recovery. Framed, Offended, where he's just saying, like, the weirdest fucking shit.
But Marshall, you are terrific, so smart and gifted. I'm so narcissistic, when I fart, I sniff it, do a fake dab, smell my armpits with it.
And then there's my favorite thing this album does. Two of his most genius things to me that he's ever done. Castle and A Rose. So Castle has three verses, each of which are supposed to be a letter being written to Haley. One before she was born, one after she was born, and then one right before he overdosed and went to the hospital. He ends the last verse talking about sliding down a slippery slope with his pharmaceuticals and whatnot.
I put out this last album and I'm done with it. 100% finished, fed up with it, I'm hanging it up, fuck it!
And you hear him take a bunch of pills and pass out. Then in A Rose, he's in the hospital. It's one big long verse, pretty much, where part of the beat is EKG machines and stuff. It's really sad, he's saying goodbye. And then he says he wants to rewrite a mistake. I'm rewinding the tape. And it literally rewinds through the whole song back to Castle in the third verse and finishes out that verse differently, where instead he discards the pills, implying that he's, you know, going on to recovery.
Even if a steep climb I must take to rewrite a mistake, I'm rewinding the tape.
I just think it's so brilliant. I think this album is really underrated. Number 5, Marshall Mathers LP. One.
I sit back with this pack of zigzags and this bag of this weed. It gives me the shit needed to be the most meanest MC on this.
I feel like there's a considerable amount of Eminem fans who put this as their number one, especially the fans who have been there from day one. I'm a little bit too young for that, to tell you the truth. This was an album that I had to listen to retroactively because I was literally born the year it came out. I was literally a fetus when my mother found me with the Marshall Mathers LP CD. She thought I was too young to hear such vulgar things. She walked in on me listening to Kim. She snapped the CD right in front of me. I didn't even speak English at the time. No, but for real, if you're going through an emo phase at some point in your childhood where you're just an emotional sad boy, this album will do wonders for you. It's to this day one of the most vulgar things I've ever heard, and I love it for that. It's also got just such a ridiculous set list. Like every song is so sick. Kill You is one of his best songs. I was hooked on The Way I Am for a long time. The Real Slim Shady, of course, one of his biggest songs ever. Marshall Mathers, hugely underrated song. Marshall Mathers is great. And obviously Stan is just a huge force to be reckoned with. But I'm gonna say it again, I think he got better over time, and this is only his second album. He fucking knocked it out of the park for his second album, don't get me wrong. But what I mean by him getting better is I think his sound got better. And as someone who is not predominantly a hip-hop listener, I take the entire piece of music into account. And to me, he still wasn't to the point where he was like making really high-quality hooks and singing in his stuff and having like really elaborate, fun beats. Fuck, that's not even true. I feel bad for saying that. I think it's just a personal preference thing, again. I think he got better at making hooks in the future. I think his beats got better in the future. I think his voice got better in the future. He was way ahead of his time with this album, though. And in a way, just right at the perfect time. Anyway, number 4, Kamikaze.
I got that
I almost think it's a good thing that people didn't like Revival because he came back so pissed off. And I love it. I love Angry Eminem. I just want him to be mad all the fucking time. I like that he dropped this album out of nowhere. I like that it's shorter than most of his other albums because the songs that are there are awesome. It's just good old-fashioned hip-hop with him being angry about his last album flopping. It's just a recipe for greatness. The Ringer, Lucky You, Not Alike, he goes so hard in all of these. Fall as well. My favorite song is probably Stepping Stone. That's just literally my favorite song he's made in like the past 7 years. This album doesn't have the most substance in the world because, like I said, it's just good old-fashioned angry hip-hop, but, you know, I love it for that. Number three, Marshall Mathers LP 2.
I got a laptop in my back pocket, my pinnacle walk when I hat cock it. Got a fat nap from that rat profit, made a living and a killing off it. Ever since Bill Clinton was still in office, with Monica Lewinsky filling on his nutsack.
I have some heavy nostalgia attached to this album because it's the first album of his that came out after I had gotten into Eminem. So it was the first album that I was eagerly waiting for him to drop and followed it the entire time with each single and learned every square inch of this album in real time with the rest of the stands. It was just such a fun experience, such a fun time for him. He was still kind of coming off the recovery hype. I feel like everyone was waiting to see what he was gonna do next. And what he ended up with was amazing. The way he turned some of the songs into sequels from the first album, with Bad Guy being like a follow-up to Stan. Parking Lot continues the little skit from Criminal. Headlights is also one of his best emotional songs, and The Monster is one of his best pop hits. Love Game with Kendrick Lamar is one of my favorite features he's had on an album.
She doesn't love me. No, she don't love me no more. She hates my company.
Also, Rick Rubin, who's kind of like music Jesus, sort of like a philosophical music guru of a producer, worked on this album, and we got some just slapping old school inspired hits like Berserk. I just feel like this is one of his best examples of the entire album being listenable from start to finish and all working together and having a really clear overall sound and being really true to him and really personal and also just being catchy and having some amazing lyrics. Number two, unfortunately, one of Marshall's least favorite albums of his own. Relapse.
There they go, back in stadiums, as shady spits his flow. Nuts they go, macadamian they go, so ballistic, whoa. He can make them look like bozos, he's wondering if he should spit this slow. Fuck no.
I don't get the hate. I really don't. I get why he's kind of embarrassed of it. He's talked about how after he made this album, he would listen to it and be like, fuck, I didn't realize I was using that many accents.
Oh, Jesus Christ, I didn't even realize I was doing that many accents.
And that seems to be really the only point of shit-talking for it, is the weird accents that he uses. But I think most people seem to agree that the music is really cool and the lyrics are super unique.
Insanity, can it be vanity? Where's the humanity in having a twisted fantasy with an arm and leg amputee? Straight jacket with 108 brackets and a strap that wraps twice around my back, then they latch it.
It's got such a dark, twisted, serial killer, drug addict vibe to the whole thing. It's just beautiful to me. I don't know why. He says some of the most outlandish shit in this album too.
They call me the Fruit Loop from Jupiter. I'm trying to maneuver the Hoover up in your poop chute. Don't move with your mic, get it stuck so fucking far up in your uvula. You ain't gonna know what he was trying to do to your gluteus.
We Made You is one of my favorite of his kind of like poppier hits. I know it was banned in a lot of places because of how many celebrities he makes fun of, but I think it's such a well-made song.
You know you want me to. Don't try to deny it, baby.
Beautiful as well is one of his most beautiful songs.
In my shoes, just to see what it's like to be me. I'll be you, like straight shoes, just to see what it'd be like to.
No accents in that one. Insane goes so hard. Insane is insane.
Hey. Skeletons in my closet, under my bed, no, under my faucet. Then you would know I completely crossed it.
Is he nuts? No, he's insane.
This also, to me, marked the very clear distinction in the two sides of his career. My mind almost breaks up Eminem into pre-relapse and post-relapse. He emerged from his addiction like a completely different person and made completely different music. It's so clear that he just had so much shit to share. Even his rare unreleased tracks from this time go really hard. There's one in particular that clearly sounds like it was supposed to be on Relapse with B.O.B. in it. It's called like Going Crazy or something.
Oh my gosh, I'm putting the Tasha Bedingfield in the washer. Watch it go from rinse to the spin cycle. It's like I gotcha, hypnotized and I forgotcha. My gotcha psychological. Michael's like an apology, what? Tell that psycho to stick a psycho truck in a white tricycle up his butt and glue the seat of his bicycle. It was nuts.
I again, I just think Relapse is one of the most unique things I've ever heard. And I think that's what really draws me to it. I find myself coming back to this album far more frequently than some of his other ones. Before we get into number one, I'd like to talk about my real number one that's unfortunately not included in this list. Kind of a honorary mention. The Bad Meets Evil album, Hell the Sequel. It was teased 12 years before it came out in the song Bad Meets Evil.
This is what happens when bad meets evil. We at the trees till we look like Vietnamese people.
They even literally say, see you in hell for the sequel.
See you in hell for the sequel.
But man, talking about just like raw fucking hip hop power of Kamikaze, this album is that to the max.
All if she could just puke from sipping this piss from my 24-inch cap to the cord. I'm the type that'll take a bath on a horse, drown her, bang her head on the passenger door when I'm stashing her in the back, smacking her forehead on the dash till it's accidentally blown, a binge porn. Riding to the cord, to the phone, cold all the way down to my soul, from my head to my toe. Ever since I was 13, I learned how to sew and so shut my own booty hole. Cause I ain't took no shit since I looked down at my nuts and saw my first pubic growth.
I think most people have only ever heard Fastlane and Lighters, because they were the two singles that got turned into music videos from this album. And I don't even think a lot of people realize that it wasn't just straight up an Eminem song, and that it's a different artist name called Bad Meets Evil. Like, I don't even know if most people are aware that this album was a thing, that don't regularly listen to Eminem at least. This album to me is literally the only no-skip hip-hop album for me personally. I listen to every single one of these songs all the time, like all the fucking time. I worship this album like it's the Flying Spaghetti Monster. All right, that is all. Number one, Recovery.
I'm alive again, more alive than I had been in my whole entire life. I can see these people's ears perk up as I begin to spaz with the pen.
There's nothing I can say about Eminem's quality of work that doesn't fit into this album. This is just revitalized, passionate Marshall fucking Mathers back in business. This album in this era of Eminem was so goddamn impactful and meaningful to me. It's probably just an age thing, honestly. It's probably just because this is the quintessential Eminem album that got me hooked on Eminem. I mean, I was 10 when this album came out, so this was really the first time that I was even aware of Eminem, and everything about this struck a chord with me. I love the way it's mixed. I love the way his vocals are mixed. It's really utilizing the natural EQ of his own voice. It's very, like, mid-high end, which is where his voice sits, and especially when he's yelling so much like he does in this record.
He slugs your BBs, your beanbag bullets, you're full of it, you were dissing his CDs, laughed at infinite, now he's back like someone pissed in his Wheaties.
Everything he says is so sharp. Oh, it's so good. It's also, to me, is some of the most catchy his rapping ever was. It was really easy to grasp and memorize, but also not too dumbed down. He still had really complex rhyme schemes, even in his freestyles.
That thought is impossible, is it blasting across the news? Pause, the news was caught with a prostitute, with a huge Johnson boobs and a monstrous tube, a loop and a bra, some boots, some panties and an aqua blue monster swallowing a popsicle playing tonsil pool. So kill the rumors, it ain't happening, I'm a rap till I'm fossil fuel.
I think his hooks were great in Relapse, but his hooks just like really hit their stride in Recovery to me. At its worst, it's a little bit cheesy. I don't really listen to You're Never Over. I think You're Never Over is the worst song in it. But at its best, it is the representation of a man done hiding behind hardships and embracing a new way of living, it seems like.
The last 2 hours didn't count. Encore, I was on drugs. Relapse, I was flushing them out. I've come to make it up to you now, no more fucking around. I got something to prove to fans because I feel like I let them down.
You can just feel his passion, and I love the way this album sounds. I love how guitar heavy it is, and the beats are so 2010, and his voice was just peaking at this time. He was like the best at singing he'd ever been. His voice got deeper as he got older, and I think this was the prime time for that before he started to kind of calm down, I guess, because I would consider his new music pretty calm compared to this. He was just so melodic and expressive. I wish we would have gotten more years out of this sound. But lucky for me, since I love this era so much, he did do a plethora of features on other people's songs while having this sound.
Like a dungeon dragon, you fell off, they must have pumped your wagon, you must have went off the back, I'm about to go off the deep and told his Daniel Lane, you just jumped in track. Cause he never risked shit, he hoped and he wished it, but it didn't fall in his lap, so he ain't even here, he pretends that
airplanes in the night sky.
Me and you were like a crew, I was like your sidekick, you gon' either wanna fight when I get off this fucking mic or you gon' hug me, but I'm out of options, there's nothing else I can do, cause this is all I know, this is why so hard I go, but I gotta put my heart and soul in this more than anybody knows, I'm trapped, so all I do is rap, and every time I rap, I'm more trapped, and I wrap myself right into this bubble, uh-oh, guess it's bubble wrap.
There's a fucking, oof, there's an unreleased song from this album called Fly Away. I think he was trying to get Rihanna to do the hook, and it never happened or something. But either way, this line right here perfectly sums up recovery.
I took a hiatus, haters, now I'm back to cause trouble. Got the fucking shape of mushroom clouds for thought bubbles.
And I don't know if you've heard the little freestyle promo called Despicable that was made for this album, but that was my shit.
No sense screaming and arguing, makes no difference whether a Benz, a Bentley, or a Beam is the car you win. You think you ball? Well, I palm it. I throw up bombs when I vomit. Pour, I throw down in the kitchen. Might hit your mom with my omelet.
You need to listen to that if you haven't. Anyways, I should probably stop because I feel like I could just ramble about this forever. Like always, these are just opinions, not facts. Please do not get angry in the comments. Just tell me your opinions and we can politely discuss them. I'm not gonna shit on you if you don't shit on me. When it comes to someone of this caliber, there's almost no wrong opinions. Everything he makes is pretty great. Can we all agree upon that? All right, I'll see you in the next one.
But you can see why, if you do Sarah Palin, people might think, oh, he wants to make a statement about Sarah Palin or American politics.
I do. I want to nail her.